Well, welcome and God bless you. My name is Paul Berry. I'm the senior pastor of Calvary Chapel, Santa Maria. I believe this is a unique opportunity for us on cable access TV to bring you segments of our regular services here. A service that is going to include not only the Word of God, line by line, precept by precept, but also that Word in the power of the Holy Ghost to change your life, even as I've seen it change so many people's lives in our congregation. I believe the Word of God has a unique power, a power that's far beyond the ability of speakers or churches that can affect your life, change your life. Romans 10 verse 17 says, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. So as you listen to the Word of God this morning, in the power of the Holy Spirit, let it change you, let it change your neighborhood, let it change the place in which you work, let it change your family, let it change the things that the Lord wants you to occupy until He is the bridegroom, comes for His blessed bride, the church. And I pray that that's soon. God bless you.
Now, as we've studied verses 15 through 20, and Jesus says within the church, there is this method, this prescription for dealing with offenses within the church. And now, Peter, in response to Jesus telling them how to do this, he asks a question that probably you've asked as well in verse 21. He says, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me, and I forgive them? And then he offers, well, up to seven times. Now, you would think, that's pretty hard-hearted, Peter. But in reality, the rabbinical Hebraic tradition in those days was that you could possibly forgive a person three times, but that's it. After they've sinned in the same sin three times, you are done with them. One rabbi by the name of Ben Hanina said, he who begs forgiveness from his neighbor must not do so more than three times. Wow. Jesus would say in the Luke gospel, and if a man sins against you seven times a day, and seven times in a day returns to you saying, I repent, you shall forgive him. So Peter is being rather gracious, I guess, with respect to what he's been taught in Hebrew school by proposing to Jesus, well, you know, be a little bit nicer to everyone else. How about seven times? Now, if in fact the law of Moses and the law of the church today was that you are allowed three sins in your life, how many of you would have passed that horizon a long time ago? I would have as well. And Jesus's his response to Peter is one that is not only reassuring to all of us, but really lends itself to the story that comes after that. Now, when the world says, I'm sorry, and doesn't require any response whatsoever, it allows them indeed to keep some record of wrongdoing with respect to you. And that's in fact what Peter's proposing. He's saying, well, you know, I'm going to write down in this ledger book that there's once, there's twice, there's three times you're out. No, I'll go up to seven. Seven, you're on number six. You go to seven and I'm done with you. Can you imagine how would a marriage work if that's what we were taught? How would just even employment or even things within the church work if that was so? In fact, all of us being well beyond the number seven, this church would be empty because there'd be no resolve to the problem of forgiveness. Jesus' response to him is important to each of us. When he says in verse 22, I do not say to you up to seven times. Jesus has never said that. He's saying, listen, Peter, I never mentioned seven times. But what I'm saying to you is 70 times seven. 490 times. And in reality, he's not really saying, listen, now keep a ledger up to 490 times, because I'm here to say to you, I've clearly sinned more than 490 times. Okay, in 62 years, I passed that horizon a long time ago. And maybe you have as well. In fact, Spurgeon puts us this way. Our Lord intends to teach us to forgive always and without end. He sets no limit. I say not unto thee until seven times. That's removing all limit. Measured mercy is not according to the command. We may read the words of our Lord in this verse as 77 times, or 70 times 7, or 490 times, but there is no occasion to be very definite about numbers when there is an indefinite number that is meant. Now, I discover that, in fact, the very definition of love, everybody knows the love chapter, right? 1 Corinthians chapter 13. It's born out of Jesus' heart, really, to gift his church with a sense about what we are to do if we want to be like Jesus. Well, love is so beautifully defined in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And did you know, in verses 4 and 5, it actually speaks about keeping an account of other people's sin. Here's what it says, verse 4. Love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, verse 5. It is never rude, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, and here's my point, it keeps no record of wrongs. No record. In other words, if you've got a list maker on your iPhone or your Android, God always conclude those because people get upset. If you have some record or legal sheet or you've got a spreadsheet and you're keeping account of what people have done against you, listen, you don't know anything about love is what it comes down to. That's what Jesus is saying. Through Paul to the Corinthians, certainly the Holy Spirit is saying, listen, if you understand the love by which Jesus has loved you, then your response to be more like Jesus is you will never keep a record of other people's wrongs against you. Now that's, I guess it's easy enough to say, but perhaps it's not so easy to live out. Because as I said, I've met couples, I've met individuals who for decades have dealt with such desperate harms in their lives that they just can't let them go. And the end result is they really have kind of washed themselves of society. Women who've been harmed by men, I'll never trust another man. Men can't be trusted. Men that have been harmed by women, I'll never trust another woman. And it's, you know, I can make this generic kind of declaration regarding people that they can't be trusted. And listen, the reality of all of this is that Jesus said, in this world, there's going to be offense. In this church, there's going to be offense. But I give you a solution to those offenses, and that's what I'm offering for you this morning. That there is a method to liberate each other through forgiveness that could be perhaps, as Jack Hayford says, the greatest gift you've ever given someone else. And you know what? I can say, I think, with pretty safely that every person here needs to know the mechanics of Jesus forgiving a little bit better. He puts it this way. In 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, he says that if we confess our sins, Jesus, he is faithful and just. Isn't that wonderful? Our Jesus is faithful. In other words, what he has promised to you, he will absolutely deliver. He is just also because he knows what exactly has happened, but he responds to our confession of sin. When we agree with God concerning what we have done, he is faithful and just to forgive you of that sin. But this is glorious. This is so glorious. He cleanses, he purifies you of all wrongdoing. In other words, if you come to Jesus, and it does say sins, plural there, hamartia, but in reality, if you just mention one sin before Jesus, I agree with you, Confession, homo legeo, means to agree with God, to say, yes, I speak of this the same way that you speak of it. I confess my sin or sins. And you know what Jesus' response is? Well, you mentioned that sin, but I'm not going to forgive you of all the others because you haven't mentioned them yet. Human beings are that way. Well, okay, I'll stir up my heart to forgive you in sincerity for that one thing. But behind the scenes, I've got this huge record of wrongdoing that I will still hold against you because you haven't come to reckoning with me so far. But Jesus says, you ask forgiveness for one thing. One thing, and I will cleanse you, I will wash you, I will purify you of all unrighteousness. Imagine that. Everything that you have ever done against the Lord God Almighty, it's as though that record of wrongdoing is stripped from its pages and burned in the halls of our tabernacle in heaven. God has nothing to do with it, and if it was possible for God to forget it, I believe that He would, but it's impossible for God to forget anything. But His commitment to you is this: I will wash you, I will cleanse you, I will purify you of everything that you have ever done just by simply confessing, if need be, one sin. That's glorious. And it's born out of some pretty heavy theology, and I won't burden you with that this morning, but Paul, writing to the church in Rome, he's astonished at what he calls justification. Justification, which actually is tied to 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. And it means that I have cleansed you of that sin to such a degree that I will never, ever treat you as though you committed that sin. That's astonishing. You see, Jesus, in forgiving you of that sin, no matter what it is, there is no sin that He will not forgive. He will forgive all sins. But in forgiving you of that, He immediately and eternally refuses to treat you as though you had committed that sin prior. So there's not only no 490, there's not even a number two. There isn't a second offense because you confessed that first offense and He has cleansed you of all of your sins. And by the way, this theological term of justification that Paul so beautifully lays out in Romans chapter 2 through 4 says to you, I commit myself. Imagine God in heaven saying, I commit myself to you to treat you as though you never committed that sin. Now that's trust, isn't it? That is love beyond all possible forms we understand. But you see, if we're going to be like Jesus, and really to be a Christian means that you're endeavoring every day to be more like Jesus in every possible way. So we want to learn to forgive like Jesus as well, which means that when you forgive someone, you are actually committing yourself to not only washing them of that wrongdoing, but furthermore, because of 1 John 1, 9, washing them of all wrongdoing, and committed also to treat them as though they have never committed that sin before. You are placing that human being, that adult, maybe that old person like me, in a position where they are just an innocent child. As Jesus said, hinder them not from coming unto me. You are placing them in a position of innocence and absence of wrongdoing. And you're saying to them, I will never remember what you have done. I'm committed to treating you as though you've never done that, because that's in reality what Jesus has done for me. Now that's a big walnut to swallow, I know, sometimes. Because you know what? We're capable of doing things against others that are so heinous, so horrifying, so scarring that that's why churches do counseling. That's because we're helping people to come to a place where they can release entirely. Really, I think the whole thing about counseling is releasing others entirely from wrongdoing. So wives whose husbands have committed infidelity, in Jesus' style of ministry can release them and say, not only do I love you, but I will commit myself to never treating you as though you had committed that sin. Now, wives, I know a lot of you would say, inconceivable. Do you like that movie where it goes, yeah. Inconceivable. But it is conceivable when you begin to understand what Jesus has done for you. Here's the story. Here's the parable. And I hope that as we go through this parable, you're going to discover, wow, it's astonishing what Jesus has done for me. And he is asking me to treat others the same way that he has treated me. Here's the story. It's a powerful one. Verse 23. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And when he had begun to settle accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. Now, it doesn't mean that, you know, song and dance is one of those talents and then, hey, watch, pull you out, you know. A talent is a weight. It's a weight of gold or silver of precious metals. Now, 10,000 talents, a talent, depending on the king, would be somewhere between 60 and 80 pounds. One talent, 60 to 80 pounds of pure gold. 10,000 talents, and that's a phenomenal number. But in reality, Jesus is simply saying this, your sin before my Father's throne is not just a pittance, not a halfpenny, but it's 10,000 times 80 pounds of solid gold. Friends, I looked on the internet, and Wednesday's price for an ounce of gold was way up, $1,300. So when you talk about 10,000 talents of gold, we're talking about $1,675,000. $1,675,000. Now, I suppose it's possible some of you would say, well, that's chump change. No problem. Here you go. See you later. But in reality, I think it's intended to be a number that is astronomical. Just we can't grasp that number because we're just common people. I mean, I couldn't preach this down in Santa Barbara because there'd be some of those that could, I'll write a check right now. No problem. See you later. Don't bother me. I'm done with this sermon, okay? But I would say every one of us here is like, I'm lost. We must have known what we did with that money. Maybe the wise king is saying, okay, show me the assets that you purchased. Maybe they've appreciated, let's settle accounts. He's got nothing. He's got nothing. And so it says in verse 26, the servant fell before him and said, Master, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. Now, I don't know what you make an hour, but if you're going to be paying back $1,675,000, it's going to be a while. Patience? Are you kidding me? That's like the definition of patience. Then the master of that servant was moved with compassion. Now, it's just one sentence. But you see, in the midst of that falling, it actually means that the servant fell at the master's feet and began to kiss his feet. Proskuneo. You know that word, Dan, don't you? It's a word of such humility that he came before his master and said, I'm kissing your dusty, dirty feet, that you would have compassion on my debt. And perhaps you would find a way to forgive me. I tell you what, that night I asked Jesus into my heart. That's exactly what I did. If I could have kissed his feet, if I could have washed his feet with my tears, I certainly had them, and I certainly would have done that. You see the connection, I hope, at this point. And the master had compassion, and he released him, and he forgave him the debt. Tells us something about this master, doesn't it? It's not as though $1,675,000 is meaningless to him, okay? Because he knows exactly how much this servant owes him. But his compassion and his love has eclipsed the account. And he has said within his heart, to me, to have this humility, to have this love that you're expressing towards me, is more valuable to me at this point than any amount of money that you could ever pay me. I not only forgive you, but I release you from every portion of this account. Friends, that's the experience. It's actually the testimony of every single Christian. In coming to know Jesus as your Savior, what you have said is this: Jesus, I have come to your feet and I beg for your forgiveness. And I pray that the power of your blood is sufficient, it is capable, it is powerful enough to deal with my 10,000 talents of sin in the record of your account. At the age of 22, you would think that perhaps somebody at that age would not have that many sins. But I knew without a doubt that as I begged for the blood of Jesus to wash me of all my wrongdoing, and in fact, following the Campus Crusade for Christ, Bill Bright's little pamphlet, I wrote what I knew were my sins. Believe me, it wasn't a complete list. But I took them outside. The instruction was to write 1 John 1:9 across the face of that sheet. It was the first time in my life that I recognized that there was a God in heaven who had made it possible for my severe debt to finally be paid out of the faithfulness and the justice of the Almighty God to forgive me my sins and cleanse me of all unrighteousness. Now, God didn't later say, you can finish that list whenever you get around to it. He gave it all to me. He took it. He washed me. And it's the first time in my life that I began to understand this is what Jesus would have you do as well. And this is the parable that really proves it. So now that servant, having been forgiven his debt, went out in verse 28 and found one of his fellow servants, another of the servants to the same master. And this other servant owed him 100 denarii. And he laid hands on him and took him by the throat and said, pay me what you owe. Took him by the like this and pay me what you owe. 100 denarii. Now a denarii is about 16 cents. It was what a field laborer would be paid for one day's labor. 16 cents. And this guy took him by the throat and said, you will pay me all you owe me. By the way, Spurgeon says this guy didn't even know how much he owed him. But it didn't matter if it was 1 cent or only 16 cents or $16. You will pay me. You will pay me now. I don't know what happened between that encounter with his master and this encounter with a fellow servant. But you begin to see what Jesus is attempting to apply to us if we're not willing to do for others what has also been done for us. And he took him by the throat, and the fellow servant fell down in verse 29 and begged him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. Do you see the exact same verbiage that the servant said to his master? Verse 30, and he would not, but went and threw him into prison till he would pay the debt. So the same thing occurred. The other servant came and kissed the feet of that unforgiving servant. The same acts, but there was no compassion. There was no release. There was no liberty offered. There was no resolution to $16 of debt. Now, I want to ask you this morning, are you the servant with $1,675,000 debt with Jesus? Or are you the servant with $16 of debt with Jesus? Either way, you've got a debt. Either way, there is only one way to pay that debt, And it is through the liberating, wonderful dialogue of confession and forgiveness. This is how Jesus concludes it. So when the fellow servants, verse 31, had seen what was done, they were extremely grieved and came and told their master all that had been done. Then his master, after he had been called, said to him, "You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you begged me. You kissed my feet." Proskuneo. "Should you ought not also have had compassion on your fellow servant, just as I had pity on you?" And his master was angry and delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due him. Now, verse 33 tells us that when this other servant had come to kiss that unforgiving servant's feet, he said there should have been exactly like compassion. You guys should have been scrambling on the dirt floor to see who would kiss the other person's feet first. But none of that happened. In fact, you refused to offer forgiveness. You decided that $16 to you was more important than $1.675 million to me. So you shall be tortured until every penny has been paid. Here's the conclusion, verse 35. "So my heavenly Father also will do to you." He's saying this to every one of us this morning. "So my heavenly Father will do to you if each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses." See, now, you came by faith to Jesus and pled. You humbly, earnestly, with compassion, begged him to forgive you. And you knew by faith, because you were convinced by the Holy Ghost, that if you asked for that, Jesus would entirely wash you, not only of that sin, but all unrighteousness. And hallelujah, we are set free by that. But how dare you go from there and to anyone in life, no matter what their debt is against you? How dare you, any one of you, refuse to give forgiveness to somebody else? Jesus would say, "You levy unforgiveness, I will levy the same to you, and what you owed prior, you will owe even in fullness." Now that scares me. It does. Because I am fully aware of what a grand sinner, professional sinner in my life I have been. And who has been forgiven much, loves much. Friends, I want you to know that.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that broadcast. I pray that the Word of God affected your life and will go forth from your head to your heart and begin to affect your family, affect your neighborhood, affect your workplace. We welcome you to join us on Sunday mornings at 8:30 and 10:30, but only if you're not attending a church elsewhere in this community. I welcome you also to consider how the Lord would use you with this word and in His Spirit to do something eternal in these last days. God bless you. Once again, this is Paul Berry, Senior Pastor of Calvary Chapel.